Right. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to be chairing this special session, which is sponsored by the Kavli Foundation. Fred Kavli was a Norwegian who built up a successful business in California and set up a foundation which supports research into big questions in science, particularly cosmology, particle physics, and brain science. And this session consists of three invited contributions. It's my pleasure to invite Barbara Jacak to give the first talk on the topic of quark gluon plasma, surprises from strongly coupled QCD matter. Thank you. Barbara.
It is my great pleasure and privilege to talk to you this morning about quark gluon plasma, and I'll tell you some of the surprises we've seen from strongly coupled matter and where do we go next. So I'll start by talking about why do we want to study quark gluon plasma, tell you a little bit about what we've discovered so far about the properties of this plasma. It's a nearly perfect liquid that's very opaque to particles that interact via the strong interaction, and it has a lot of similarities to other strongly coupled and strongly correlated systems. I'll then talk about some recent insights and surprises, and then I'll tell you where I think we need to go to really understand how strongly coupled QCD matter works. So how do we produce the hottest matter? Well, we collide heavy ions in the relativistic heavy ion collider at Brookhaven or the LHC at CERN, and by doing that, we heat the matter to 10 to the 12th kelvins, 300 MeV or so, and that puts us somewhere here in the quark gluon plasma regime of the phase diagram of QCD matter, where this is the temperature and this is the baryon density. The exact path one follows through depends on the energy of the collisions. And of course, since you can't put the quark gluon plasma in a box when you make it in a collider, it then expands and cools back down to the regime of normal nuclear matter. The big question, of course, is how does this stuff work? Now, to orient you a bit of the steps in producing, studying, and then evaporating a quark gluon plasma, I have here some pictures from an actual model of the collisions. Here you see the initial state to Lorentz contracted nuclei that are about to collide. Here they interact with one another, produce many partons, quarks, and gluons. They interact and produce a plasma, which then expands and cools. Now, to understand what's happening inside the plasma, it's useful to think about the potential between a pair of quarks. Plotted here is the potential as a function of the distance between quarks. As you see, as the distance gets larger to 12, 13, 14 Fermi, the potential rises, the force between the quarks gets stronger, and that's what gives rise to the confinement of quarks inside hadrons. Conversely, you see as the distance gets much smaller, the potential drops, and that's the asymptotic freedom. Now, one can solve QCD on the lattice, and with that, one can look to see what happens to this potential as you raise the temperature of the plasma. And what you see here, this black line is just this potential right here, and you see as the temperature goes up and up in these colored lines, the potential becomes screened until finally at some critical temperature, the potential is completely screened away, and instead of bound quarks, you have a plasma of quarks and gluons. So what we do is then look at the particles at the very end after the collision is finished, and what we see are groups of hadrons, and all of those particles flow as if they're frozen out from a flowing soup of the constituent quarks. We compare small systems, proton-proton and p-lead, to our heavy ion collisions in order to see what the volume does, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Now, you might be wondering, in these very messy collisions, how can you actually study the properties of such a plasma, particularly since it only lives for about 10 to the minus 23 seconds? So what we do is we use a combination of internal and external probes in the language of plasma physics. Our internal probes are the particles that are radiated from the bulk of the plasma, and those are particles here in the momentum spectrum with momenta transverse to the beam less than about 1.5 or 2 GeV. Those are thermal particles from the plasma. We also can look at the particles above 3, 4, 5 GeV, and those are our equivalent of an external probe. Now, where those come from, they're actually auto-generated in the collision, as you can see in this cartoon up here. When the nuclei first interpenetrate, you can have a very high momentum transfer collision between a gluon or a quark from each nucleus. That high momentum transfer kicks them off at 90 degrees, and they have to make their way out through the plasma before getting to our detector. And so if you look at these higher momentum particles, they're the remnants of this hard scattered quark or gluon. Those are very nice. They can be calculated by QCD using perturbation theory. So we know what we're doing, we know what we expect, and then you can see what the plasma does. Now, of course, any good measurement needs to have a control, and our control probe are photons, which don't participate in the strong interaction. So when we first turned on the relativistic heavy ion collider, we made two major discoveries. The first one is that this plasma actually flows collectively, and I'll tell you how we know that and what that's good for. And we also discovered that the plasma is very opaque to quarks and gluons, and that causes jets to be quenched. So let me start by talking about the collective flow. Now, you might wonder, in such a complicated collision, how can you measure the collective flow? So here's a cartoon of two nuclei that have just passed through one another. And if you look at the beam's eye view, you see what the cartoon has already shown you, which is that the overlap region is asymmetric. It's not spherically symmetric. So that says that if you produce a lot of particles in that kind of almond-shaped region, you're going to build up some fairly high pressure gradients, and they're going to be higher in the x direction than the y direction because you stuff more things into a smaller space. Those pressure gradients can translate this initial spatial asymmetry into a momentum space anisotropy, and that's something we can look for experimentally. The way we do that is actually simple. You look at the opening angle between all the pairs of particles around the azimuthal direction. If there is a preferred direction, then you're going to find more particles at small opening angle and more particles at 180 degrees. If there's no preferred direction, that distribution will be flat. So you've been already looking at the data and your eye tells you that's not flat. There is a preferred direction. One can Fourier analyze this shape here and actually quantify this amplitude, and that tells you how large the initial pressure gradient was. And that's measured by the second Fourier component, which we call V2, or elliptic flow. So here's a plot of V2, early measurements of V2, and they're plotted as a function of the impact parameter in the collision, with very peripheral collisions here. Those are the ones with the largest spatial asymmetry, to very small impact parameters where the spatial asymmetry becomes rather smaller and the pressure gradients then also become smaller. So you can see that this elliptic flow is like at the range of 7 or 8%. Now we can look more differentially than that as a function of the transverse momentum of the particles, and that's a function of the mass of the particles. Here are pions, here are protons and antiprotons. And you can see that this is a very large anisotropy that we see in the final state. That means that two things. One is that the pressure buildup is very large. There's another thing that we can do, and that is to compare the data to calculations from hydrodynamics. Those are these red and blue lines. The first thing that your eye tells you is you need to look at the red line to see agreement with the data, and that tells us that the system has to spend some of its time in the quark gluon plasma phase. Otherwise, you have the wrong equation of state, and you don't reproduce the data with hydrodynamics. We also learned that the isotropization, the thermalization inside this plasma, happens very quickly. Otherwise, the hydrodynamics doesn't reproduce the data. We learned one other thing from the comparison with hydrodynamics, and that is that the viscosity over entropy ratio is very small. It's quite near zero, and that's why we can say that the quark gluon plasma is a perfect liquid. Now let's think a little bit about viscosity. Viscosity is the inability to sustain a wave and transport momentum. So with small viscosity, it means you can get a very nice wave. And that means that the interaction cross-section among the stuff inside is large. For quark gluon plasma, the viscosity to entropy ratio, that's like the viscosity per particle, is very near 1 over 4 pi, which is the limit from quantum mechanics. Now, how small is the viscosity over entropy ratio in quark gluon plasma? Well, plotted here are some more familiar liquids. Here's water. Here's liquid helium. Here are ultra-cold atoms where one can excite a resonance to create a strong coupling and an elliptic flow. And here is quark gluon plasma, and you can see that it's for sure lower than the lower than helium and water, probably lower than the ultra-cold atoms also, though we still have some work to do to make that error bar smaller. Now, if we have good momentum transport that you need to have these nearly frictionless flows, that means that the neighboring fluid elements in this plasma talk to each other. We see that hydrodynamics works very well. So if these fluid elements talk to each other, that tells us that the quark gluon plasma is strongly coupled. If it's strongly coupled, it should be opaque to particles that you try to send through it. So that's something that we can also measure experimentally. And the way we do that is with our internally generated external probes, if you will, these hard-scattered quarks or gluons that make their way through the plasma. So to see what the effect of the plasma is on those, we first measure in proton-proton collisions. You see here the spectrum of pions and proton-proton collisions. The lines are calculations with perturbative QCD, and you see that works quite well in proton-proton collisions. So now we can make the same measurement in gold-gold collisions. And here's in red what the gold-gold spectrum looks like for collisions that are nearly head-on, so a large number of nucleon-nucleon collisions. We compare those, this red line, to the PP collisions scaled up by the number of individual nucleon-nucleon collisions inside this volume. And right away, your eye tells you there's a really major deficit. You can take the ratio of the red over the blue. We call that the nuclear modification factor, or RAA for short. And this is that ratio here shown in red. And you can see that the number of pions that you see in head-on gold-gold collisions is about 1/5 of what you expect from the incoming nucleons. That's pretty opaque. And shown here in blue is what happens to the photons. Those shouldn't be suppressed, and indeed they're not. The fact that that ratio is 1, as you would expect, tells us we understand our geometry, we understand what we're doing, and those pions really are very suppressed. Now, at the LHC, one can go to much higher momentum probes. What you see here is the spectrum of charged particles out to 100 GeV, and actually the spectrum of jets out to 300 GeV. And you see even these multi-hundred GeV quarks or gluons that make their way through the plasma are substantially suppressed by over a factor of 2. Once again, the control probe is here. Here you see photons, W and Z bosons, and those are not suppressed. So this is definitely a plasma effect on the strongly coupled on the strongly interacting quarks and gluons. Now, we can do better than that. Remember, I showed you in the cartoon that when you have the hard scattering, there are 2 partons that go off one against the other. So what you can do is trigger on one high momentum, either particle or jet, and then look at the other one that had to make its way all the way through the plasma. And here is a picture of a it's one event from CMS doing just that. What you see here is a jet with a total energy of 205 GeV. That's this guy. Now let's see what happens 180 degrees away in azimuth. What happened to the jet that had to go all the way through the plasma? And here you see its wimpy little remainder with only 70 GeV. So that jet has actually dumped more than 100 GeV into the quark gluon plasma. So one would like to know what happens to that 100 GeV that you've just dumped into the plasma. And to do that, you would like to calculate what are the transport properties of quark gluon plasma. Well, we know how to calculate transport in the weak coupling limit. We can use perturbative QCD, kinetic theory, and follow cascades of partonic interactions. Of course, I've shown you from the flow and the opacity that the system is not weakly coupled and perturbative QCD isn't the right approximation. We do know how to solve QCD on the lattice. Then you can take all of the multiparticle interactions into account. The problem there is that the lattice is a static object. It's very difficult to calculate transport on the lattice. So what do you do? Well, some very smart people from string theory came along and said, well, we should try the opposite assumption that perhaps the system is infinitely strongly coupled. And there, by using ADS-CFT, which is the duality between a supersymmetric field theory like QCD and gravity, then you actually have a way that you can calculate some of the transport properties. Now, I want to just comment about strongly coupled matter in different areas of physics. Turns out that across many subfields of physics, strong coupling is really a forefront interest. Plasma physicists study dusty plasmas and warm dense plasmas, all of which have liquid and even crystalline phases due to their strong coupling. In cold atoms, when you excite a resonance that causes strong coupling, you actually can get an elliptic flow in an ultra-cold atomic gas at 10 to the minus 7th kelvins that looks exactly the same as the elliptic flow that we see at 10 to the 12th kelvins. Of course, in condensed matter, there's a lot of research into strongly correlated systems. There are very interesting liquid crystal and superconducting phases. What's interesting is in all of these cases, you have a competition between the attractive forces and either repulsive forces in among the particles or kinetic energy that pushes them apart. And as a result of that competition, in all of these cases, you're looking at many-body interactions, and pairwise approximations just simply don't work. Now, QCD is a very good test lab for this because we do know the Lagrangian. So let me then turn to some of the newer surprises that we've been having. It's, of course, natural to have a look at small systems. How small of a droplet of quark gluon plasma can you possibly make? Well, what you see here are results in proton-on-lead collisions and proton-on-proton collisions. Now, these ones are selected to have those just that have more than 100 particles, charged particles, in the final state. What's plotted here is, once again, the opening angle distribution of all particle pairs. If you look at it here along the delta phi, the azimuthal opening angle direction, you once again see this double hump structure like the one that I showed you from our heavy ion collisions. This is the direction along the beam where it's elongated as the large energy of the incoming beams would lead you to expect. But look at this, you exactly see the same double hump structure. And if you look over here, even in proton-proton collisions, you see this hump here at small opening angles. There is a preference. If you Fourier analyze these, you find out that you have Fourier components from the second all the way to the fifth, just as we saw in the heavy ion collisions. Now, of course, if you have collectivity, you expect correlations not just among particle pairs, but among larger numbers of particles. And so one can look at the second Fourier component when you analyze 4, 6, 8, and even more particles, and you can see that they all agree with each other, and there is actually still a flow in proton-on-lead collisions. So you've made a little tiny droplet of quark gluon plasma. This was somewhat surprising. Perhaps that is possible once you have 100 particles or more. Other alternatives are that maybe every time the particle correlations from the early stages of the collision mock up the signal, or perhaps the signal is some artifact of how the particles freeze out when the system is sufficiently dilute that they no longer interact. Now, you might be wondering, how about in P-LED collisions do we see the energy loss of jets, as one saw in heavy ion collisions? The answer is no. On the other hand, that hotspot is pretty small, so it would be tough to suck as much energy out as a larger drop of plasma would do. Now, the fact that you can see these same kinds of signals in very small systems really underscores one of the big mysteries, which is how can a QCD matter thermalize so quickly? It's really one of the hot questions for hot QCD. How can you actually have a plasma that forms in less than a Fermi over C? Looks like you can do that even if your system is very tiny. We do have some tools to pin down the physics of many-body QCD in hot, dense matter. We can look at how the jets are quenched. We can try to look at how is the deposited energy transported. And we can also change the mass of the probe, turn up the mass of the quark, and see what happens. Other questions, of course, since you know you have multiple scattering that gives rise to this thermalization, how important is coherent scattering? And how similar are the parton interactions in hot, dense QCD matter and cold, dense QCD matter? After all, what's thermalizing starts out pretty cold. So let me say a few words about the interactions within the plasma. If you take the particle picture, which is the way at least I think, and many of us tend to think, that's very appropriate for a weak coupling approximation of what's in there. Well, the interactions are going to be radiation and collisions. The radiation is the QCD analog of Bremsstrahlung. Now, of course, we know that in a plasma, the charges of the particles are spread out and screened into a characteristic Debye length. So that's an interesting question as to what exactly the collisions are with inside a plasma. If you look at the alternative, the field picture, inspired by ADS-CFT, what you have in there is an infinitely strongly coupled QCD field. The quark and gluon interactions with that kind of a plasma are actually the, as with a teeny tiny black hole formed in each collision. So as here's your quark moving along, it's trailing a string to the event horizon of this teeny tiny, probably imaginary black hole, and losing energy along the way. In that case, the lost energy actually goes into collective excitations of the quark gluon plasma. So how can you possibly tell? Well, one of the things to do is to try and understand radiation and collisions. Can that really explain what we see? And there, we turn up the mass of the quarks and look at heavy quarks. So what's shown here is the RAA, the nuclear modification factor that measures the opacity of the plasma, to D mesons, which have a heavy charm quark. This is the blue is the measurement at RIC. The black over here is the measurement at the LHC. And you see in both cases, the D mesons are quite strongly suppressed. The red and the pink here show the suppression in the mesons that are made up out of light quarks. And you see that that suppression is exactly the same. Over here, you see the elliptic flow per quark for the D mesons here in black, and the blue and other colors are, again, mesons that have lighter and strange quarks, and you see that the flow is exactly the same. So this is actually very surprising, because if the energy loss and the kicks that the particles get to make them flow come from some combination of radiation and collisions, when you turn up the mass of the quark, you close off some of the phase space for gluons to be radiated into, and so that balance should be different, and yet the energy loss is exactly the same. ADS-CFT predicts that the energy loss for all of the quarks and gluons should be the same. So the next step experimentally is to turn up the mass of the quark even further and look at B quarks, which are significantly heavier than charm quarks. And there are first hints at both the LHC and RIC that the B is less suppressed than charm. However, we don't know for sure. We really need to have our upgrades, detector upgrades that are underway, finished in order to answer that for sure. Another tool that we have is to look at the energy flow inside the plasma. If you look at QCD, it tells us that if we have a particle that's going through a plasma, we go from the normal angular ordering as that parton fragments and turns into hadrons, the normal angular ordering is shown here in blue, to a medium-induced cascade because of all of the collisions that happen along the way, and you can see those here in red. Now, experimentally, we can try and get at that by looking inside these jets and seeing what happens to the particles in there. Does the number change? How does the spectrum of those particles change? We also know that these very high energy jets, remember this guy had 205 GeV, those are formed mostly outside the plasma. The gluons that form those, they radiate inside the plasma. Those radiations then go on and split into more gluons, but the actual jet that you see in your detector at 200 GeV forms outside the plasma. We do know that softer jets should be resolved by the plasma as they start to form already before they get out of the plasma. And that's one of our experimental goals, to get at those softer jets and see how they're modified by the plasma. Now, I've mentioned that the thermalization, how can it thermalize so fast, is one of the really big questions in our field. And I just want to point out that that's actually a complicated question to answer. In proton nucleus collisions, what you do is you probe your cold, dense nucleus with a parton, not a photon. Partons, after all, feel the strong interaction, so they can lose energy before the hard scattering. That's not like a photon-induced interaction. Of course, they can lose energy after the hard scattering. That's the signal we've been measuring. They can have multiple scattering, and all the different scatterings may not be independent. There are some indications, actually, from studying many-body QCD that says there should be some coherence among the interactions. So how do we actually sort this out? Well, an important next step is to turn off the interactions that happen before the hard scattering. So how do you do that? Well, you have to change the beam. Here you can see the diagram for our hadron-hadron scattering. There the probe is a gluon. If you use an electron beam, then the probe is a photon. You have a point-like probe instead of a probe with structure. And you have no danger of mixing up the dynamics of the probe with the structure of this nucleus that you're trying to measure. Furthermore, if you have your nice point-like probe, you can control the kinematics by measuring that scattered electron. The only problem, of course, with doing this nice simple measurement of changing the beam is that we need a new collider. We need an electron-ion collider to be able to do that. However, once we have an electron-ion collider, we will also be able to answer another rather interesting question. Namely, if you excite a really tiny hotspot inside a nucleus and you dump enough energy in it with your photon, will there be hydrodynamic flow? Interestingly enough, the theorists in the field here are completely in disagreement. About half the people say yes and half say no. This is experimentalist paradise. So I just want to say that, you know, if I were betting, I might bet somebody's dog that since hot, dense gluonic matter turned out to be weird and surprising, that cold, dense gluonic matter is going to be pretty weird and surprising also. And the reason I say that is if you look deep inside a nucleus, well, the deeper you look, the smaller momentum fraction particles you look at, the more numerous the gluons are. Now, of course, you can't have an infinite number of gluons. Unitarity tells you that's not possible. And we know it's not possible because gluons, after all, interact among themselves. You can have gluon splitting. I showed you nice calculations. Well, cartoons from calculations of gluon splitting. And we know that the gluons can also recombine. So at a high enough density, what's the gluon number? It should saturate. And one of the things that we would like to do is to actually explore this diagram, namely looking at smaller and smaller gluon momentum here on the y-axis and increasing the probe energy. There should be some area above which we're looking at a saturated gluon gas. Well, maybe it's a gas. might actually have liquid properties due to strong coupling, just as the hot quark gluon plasma does. Might be better described as a pure field, as some of my theoretical colleagues tell me. I think that it will be very interesting and probably surprising when we can actually get in there and probe that. And that's another reason that we'd like to have an electron-ion collider. So, since I have 18 seconds to go, where are we? Well, I have shown you that the quark gluon plasma is strongly coupled. It's very opaque to particles that feel the strong interaction. It flows collectively. I've shown you also that very small systems show collective flow signals. And we don't really understand how this is possible. Big question, will a point-like hotspot in electron-ion collisions grow into a collectively flowing system or not? Measuring that is a very good way to test our understanding of how QCD matter transports energy. Jet modification is something we can measure now. We can see how is the QCD cascade modified. We can see what is the balance between radiation and collisions, or are we really, in fact, just making purely collective excitations in the plasma, and there are no particles in there to collide with. And we need, of course, experiment and theory working together to sort them out. I hope I've convinced you that we have a very cool tool to address this by varying the mass of the probe quark. And in a few years, one of my colleagues will be standing up here telling you what happens to B jets in the quark gluon plasma. The initial stage is a cold but also very dense medium. And I think in the short run, what we need to do is to use insights from jet modification in the hot plasma to help understand transport in the cold, dense gluon gas, which may or may not be a plasma. And I would offer to bet the life of my cat, except I don't have any pets, I'm sorry. And we will need an EIC to answer all of these questions, but that will allow us to do deep and elastic scattering off tense off of a cold, dense gluon gas, turning off the strong interaction so we can really measure the transport properties in cold, dense QCD matter. And my other answer as to where we are is we're here. This is the nice QCD Mariners landscape, and we're in this little ship here trying to stay away from the scary sea monsters, but we're going to make it over here between Terra Incognita and the EIC. Thank you.
Question there in the front.
If all else fails, I took notes on your lecture without understanding a word.
Oh, no!
That's my fault,
not
Can you suggest a book or a paper to read as a treatment
feedback to your
child? Yes, I can. Did everyone hear the question?
Okay, let me repeat the question.
Yes.
The question was whether there is a book or article that's a prequel. There is a summary article in Science a couple of years ago that I was a co-author on. Of course, I think that one's understandable, but my students tell me that they sort of understand it too, so I can give you the reference.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes, over there.
First, I want to thank you for a very beautiful talk that avoided numbers and informed the uninformed, such as myself, pretty well. The query that I have is whether you can measure the charge of the quark, actually measure things to be one-third and two-thirds in the plasma.
That's a great question. We know how to measure the flavor of the quark by looking at the final state hadrons. Whether the charge of the quark is modified in the plasma, I actually don't know how to do that. And I think that the many-body interactions might tend to fake up some kind of an interesting signal. But as far as I know, nobody has figured out how to do that.
Can we thank Barbara again for a very clear talk indeed. And we go into the next talk, which is by Cora Dvorkin from Harvard, who's going to talk about frontiers in cosmology.
Okay, hello. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'm Cora Dvorkin. I'm a professor at Harvard University, and today I will be talking about new frontiers in cosmology. So here's a roadmap of my talk. I will first start by giving an overview of the cosmic microwave background and touching base on some of the open questions that we have in cosmology today. I will tell you about some of the fundamental questions that we have in physics that we hope to improve our understanding of by using cosmological observations. In particular, I will be talking about the physics of the very early universe. The question is, what is the physics that seeded the first structures in the universe? And I divided my talk into roughly three parts. In the first part, I will be talking about the general method that I introduced with collaborators to hope to learn about the shape of the inflationary potential using CMB observations. In the second part of the talk, I will tell you how we can learn about additional degrees of freedom during inflation by using the large-scale structure in the universe. And finally, I will tell you how we can learn about the energy scale of inflation, and I will tell you the current status of our quest for primordial B-modes in the sky. Okay, so this figure over here represents 13.8 billion years of the universe. As we all know, the universe began as a hot and dense plasma of particles in thermal equilibrium. It expanded and cooled, and many physical processes happened along the way. Some of them we know pretty well, and some of them we don't know, and we are trying to understand the physics of them. So, for example, we know that we had neutrino decoupling at about an MeV, electron-positron annihilation, nucleosynthesis of the very first light elements. At redshift of about 1100, protons and electrons recombine into hydrogen in a period that we know as recombination. And since then, the universe became mainly transparent to CMB photons. So since then, the photons mainly free stream toward us until redshift of about 10 to 20, when radiation from the first stars and quasars reionized the universe, in a period that we know as reionization, and about 6% of the photons, this is the latest number, rescatter. So today, we observe these photons at microwave frequencies and at a temperature of about 2.7 Kelvin. So what we observe is these temperature fluctuations at different positions in the sky. And by measuring the statistical properties of these temperature fluctuations, we can infer the physics from the very early universe. We have learned that these temperature fluctuations are Gaussian at first order, and they have a temperature of about 100 microkelvin. So if the field is Gaussian and isotropic, all of the information is contained in the power spectrum. So we can take these temperature fluctuations that we observe at different positions in the sky and make a spherical harmonic decomposition. And by taking the two-point function of these spherical harmonic coefficients, we can compute the temperature power spectrum. Now, the temperature power spectrum has been predicted and measured with great accuracy over the last decade. I'm showing you here the temperature power spectrum as a function of multiple moment or angular scale in the sky. Okay, so this part corresponds to large angular scales, and this part corresponds to small angular scales. Now, the structure of these acoustic peaks carries the information of acoustic oscillations in the photon-baryon plasma at the time of recombination. I'm showing you here in red the data coming from the Planck satellite, and in green, I'm showing you the best fit model for this data. As you can see, this best fit model works extremely well, but it makes fundamental assumptions. It assumes that there is a single field slowly rolling down the potential. And in this, the first and second part of the talk, I will show you how we can test for these assumptions in a general and model-independent way. So here's where we stand in cosmology today. We have a standard model of cosmology known as lambda CDM. We have a homogeneous background, and we measure the parameters of this background very well. We know that we have approximately 5% of baryonic matter, 27% of cold dark matter, approximately 68% of dark energy. On top of that, we have perturbations, and we measure the parameters of these perturbations also very well. We know that these perturbations are nearly scale invariant and approximately Gaussian. So we made big strides in measuring all of these parameters. However, big questions remain. What is the lambda of our lambda CDM standard model of cosmology? What is dark energy? What is the CDM of the lambda CDM standard model of cosmology? What is the particle nature of dark matter? And what is the physics that seeded the first structures in the universe? So it's in this question that I will base my talk today. What is the physics that seeded the first structures in the universe? So let me start by telling you, by giving a little bit of a background of what is inflation. So inflation is an idea that was proposed by a number of authors in the early 1980s. And it's the main paradigm that explains the observed inhomogeneities in the universe today. It's a period of accelerated expansion, and it explains why the universe is approximately homogeneous and spatially flat. Now, the condition of being a period of accelerated expansion implies that it is sourced by a component of negative pressure. So what is this component of negative pressure that sources inflation? What causes inflation? And in the simplest models, this component can be taken to be a scalar field. Now, it is commonly assumed that there is a single scalar field slowly rolling down the potential. The equations, the evolution equations of this scalar field that we know as the inflaton field, are given by the following set of equations, where this is the Hubble expansion, this is the energy density of the inflaton field given by its kinetic energy and its potential energy, and note that the Hubble expansion appears here as a source of friction in these evolution equations. So now, as the comoving horizon is decreasing, different modes of the field cross the horizon. And when a mode of the field crosses the horizon, a perturbation is frozen at a certain scale. So we can take the two-point function of this perturbation, the curvature perturbation, that is frozen at a certain scale, and compute the initial curvature power spectrum. Now, when we have the initial curvature power spectrum, we can, a certain scale k in this initial curvature power spectrum is associated with a multiple moment L or an angular position in the sky. So at later and later times, smaller and smaller scales cross the horizon. So the idea is that by measuring different angular scales in the CMB temperature or polarization power spectrum, we can probe different areas in the inflationary potential. The physics of inflation is yet unknown, so the goal of the first part of this talk is to show you how we can shed light on the physics of inflation by using CMB observations. Okay, so here are some questions that I thought I would show. So assuming inflation took place, this is a theory, what can we learn about it? So there are a number of questions that we can hope to answer. For example, what is the shape of the inflationary potential? Are there additional degrees of freedom? What is the energy scale of inflation? And how far did the field travel? Did it travel a sub-Planckian or a super-Planckian distance in field space? So I divided my talk basically in the first part. I will touch base on the first question, and then I will go on with the rest of the questions. So let's start by talking about the shape of the inflationary potential and how we can hope to probe the shape of the inflationary potential by using CMB observations. So what is commonly done in the field is to start by a particular model of inflation. Once we have this model of inflation, we can compute the background equations and the equations of motion of the K modes of the inflaton field, or the Mukhanov-Sasaki equation, to compute the initial curvature power spectrum. Once we have the initial curvature power spectrum, we can solve for the Boltzmann equations, and compute the CMB temperature and polarization power spectra, compare the model to the data, and assess its statistical significance. Okay, so this is what is commonly done in the field. So here I will propose a method to reverse engineer and instead start from the observables, the CMB temperature and polarization power spectra, and from there impose constraints into the shape of the inflationary potential. So what is commonly used in the field is a technique known as slow roll approximation. The slow roll approximation is a commonly used approximation for inflationary models where the scalar field potential is sufficiently flat and slowly varying. However, of course, by construction, this leads to curvature power spectra that are featureless and nearly scale invariant. And this is not necessarily the case. In fact, there is some space in the data for having features in the inflationary potential, and many groups have studied this and claim detections and features at different significance. So what we did back in the day with Wayne Hu, who was my advisor at the University of Chicago, was to build up a formalism known as generalized slow roll approximation, in which we allow for having features in the inflationary potential. So this formalism is very powerful because I'm writing here the curvature power spectrum under this formalism. This equation is only here to tell you that the curvature power spectrum only depends on a single and unknown function, which is this source function over here, and the rest are known functions. These are green functions that we know. So the curvature power spectrum under this formalism depends on a single and unknown function which is responsible for the observable features in the inflationary potential. And it is simply related to the shape of the inflationary potential in the same way that tilt is in the case of standard slow roll. So you can see that the source function here depends on the second and the first derivative of the inflationary potential. And this is the only function that describes the observable features in the curvature power spectrum. Now, what we did is to describe this source function using a principal component basis. I'm writing here the source function as a constant part that is the commonly used part under the slow roll approximation, plus a part that encodes the information of features in the inflationary potential. These are eigenfunctions of the covariance matrix of perturbations in the source functions, and these are eigenvalues. So the principal components have very nice properties. So in fact, they are defined a priori from the covariance matrix. So this avoids possible a posteriori biases when looking at specific signatures in the data. They are ranked in order of observability, being the first one, the best measured one, the second best measured one, and so on. And finally, they are very easy to interpret. So non-zero values here of these components MA, the eigenvalues, represent deviations from slow roll and power law spectrum. So what we did is a Markov chain Monte Carlo likelihood analysis, taking the 6 lambda CDM standard cosmological parameters plus 20 principal components, which were enough to completely represent the observable features in the inflationary potential. And here I'm showing you the probability distribution function that came from a WMAP temperature and large-scale polarization analysis. In red, I'm showing you what we would expect from the slow roll approximation, the standard approximation. And in blue, I'm showing you the probability distribution function that came from this analysis. So what we saw here is that only 3 components out of all these 20 components exceed the 90% confidence level significance for non-zero value. In other words, we saw in a general and model-independent way that there is no significant evidence for departures from slow roll. And we continue building up on this formalism with collaborators along the year. And I will show you in the next slide our constraints using Planck data and the upcoming constraints. So now, a byproduct of this test is a model-independent test of single-field inflation. Since we are in single-field inflation, we have only one degree of freedom. So constraints on the source function also impose constraints on the E-mode CMB polarization. So we can draw upper and lower bands, constraints, that encapsulate all possible inflationary models under the single field inflation hypothesis. So measurements lying outside of these bands over here could potentially rule out single field inflation, excluding, of course, more mundane reasons such as foregrounds or systematics. And in particular, I want to emphasize the power of CMB polarization for testing features in the inflationary potential. CMB polarization is much more powerful than the temperature for probing features in the inflationary potential, and this is because differences in the transfer function. There is a much more cleaner mapping between K modes and L in the projection that allows CMB polarization for a much more clean study of features in the inflationary potential. So here are our latest updates. This is work led by Vinicius Miranda, who was a PhD student after I graduated working with Wayne on this generalized slow roll approximation. I'm showing you here the reconstruction of the initial curvature power spectrum that came using Planck temperature data. As you can see, both in the case in which we didn't have any tensor modes or in the case in which we marginalize over tensor modes, we have a suppression in power at large scales. And this has also been seen by the Planck collaboration. In the case in which we marginalize over tensor modes, this suppression in power becomes more pronounced. And this is because tensor modes add power at large scales by the expense of having less power in the initial curvature power spectrum. And right now, we are working with my graduate student, Jorge Sobied at Harvard University, doing the latest version of this reconstruction, but using all possible available data. We are using all polarization data that was released by the Planck collaboration a few months ago. And the updates on this will be available soon. So finally, I also want to mention that we can use large-scale structure data to improve constraints on the inflationary potential. This is work that I did with other collaborators in which we showed that adding large-scale structure data to the CMB observations can improve constraints on inflationary potential dramatically. Okay, so let's move on to the other question that I mentioned, which is, are there additional degrees of freedom? How can we learn if there are other additional degrees of freedom during inflation? So under single field and slow roll inflation hypothesis, we assume that the initial conditions of the universe are Gaussian. So departures from Gaussianity would point to new physics during inflation. So as I said before, a Gaussian field is completely described by its power spectrum. And if the field is non-Gaussian, other endpoint correlation functions are non-zero. In particular, the bispectrum, or the three-point correlation function, is non-zero. A model that has been worked out a lot in the literature is this local model, in which basically we take the inflaton field and make a Taylor expansion up to second order. So here, this FNL coefficient, I think my laser pointer doesn't work anymore, but the, sorry? Oh. This FNL coefficient over here measures the amplitude of the non-Gaussian signal. So in this particular model, the signal peaks in the squeeze configuration, in which one of the K modes is much shorter than the other two. Planck has looked for this configuration and saw results that are consistent with zero. So FNL is consistent with zero. Now, there is hope to learn more about these kind of models using large-scale structure data. In particular, these kinds of models have a scale-dependent halo bias at large scale. And by halo bias, I mean the coefficient that relates the halo fluctuations to the matter fluctuations. So Dalal et al. In 2008 showed that the halo bias has a 1 over k squared dependence in this kind of non-Gaussian models. So in principle, because we have 3D information in large-scale structure data, we can improve upon constraints coming from the CMB. Now, what we ask with our collaborators is, what if the FNL coefficient now depends on angular position? It's not isotropic anymore. And in fact, you would expect an angular-dependent coefficient coming from particles that have a spin different from zero in the primordial universe. And this has been pointed out in a paper in 2015 by Arkani Hamed and Maldacena. So we asked the question, can we use galaxy surveys to improve constraints on anisotropic scenarios in the same way we use galaxy surveys to improve constraints on the isotropic non-Gaussian scenario? And so for this, let me introduce the observable that we use at first, which is the intrinsic alignments of galaxies. So intrinsic alignments of galaxies are basically the correlations of the ellipticities of the galaxies. These are coherent alignments with the surrounding tidal field in the absence of lensing. So there is a model that works very well, known as the tidal alignment model, and it works very well at linear scales. So in this model, the alignment field follows the tidal field, as you can see here. And this model was proposed by Catalan and Kamienkowski and Blandford, and later refined by Chris Hirata and Uro Steljak. So the tidal alignment model provides a very good description of the observed alignments of LRGs at large scales. And in fact, this model has been worked out because the intrinsic alignments of galaxies is a major source of noise in the weak lensing community. So we decided to take what for others is a source of noise as our source of signal. And so we looked at the alignment bias, which is the coefficient relating the alignment field and the tidal field. And so we saw that, for example, for spin 2 particles, this alignment bias also carries a scale dependent, a scale dependence. So it departs from a constant at very large scales, as you can see in the plot that I'm showing here. Okay. So in the presence of anisotropic non-Gaussianity, what happens is that a long wavelength mode induces a local anisotropy in the initial curvature power spectrum, and then galaxies correlate with this anisotropic initial curvature power spectrum. So I showed you here how intrinsic correlations between galaxy shapes offer a new probe of non-Gaussianity, of primordial non-Gaussianity in the universe. Okay, so what we studied up to now with collaborators, and I showed you, is the effect of primordial particles with spin 2 on the statistics of the ellipticities of galaxies. And with my postdoc, Asadek Disga, we are studying the effect of higher spin particles that could also leave an imprint on the large-scale structure of the universe, and this is part of work in progress, and you should stay tuned for this. Okay, so the last part of my talk, I will tell you how we can learn about the energy scale of inflation and the field range by using CMB observations. So, as we all know, the CMB is linearly polarized. Polarization is generated by Thomson scattering of photons of free electrons. So it's the local temperature quadrupole that each electron sees along the line of sight that sources CMB polarization. And CMB polarization can be decomposed into E-modes and B-modes, which are the analogs of curl-free and divergence-free component of a vector field. Okay, so the E-modes have their direction radial to the cold spot and tangential to the hot spots, and the B-modes have their orientations rotated by 45 degrees with respect to the E-modes. Now, polarization transforms as a spin 2 field, so we can make the same spherical harmonic decomposition as we made with the temperature field, but now using spin 2 spherical harmonics. So if we have scalar sources plus linear evolution, we generate E-modes. Now, if we have gravitational waves distorting the space-time and creating a CMB quadrupole, or nonlinear evolution coming from gravitational lensing by massive structures distorting the path of the photons that are coming toward us, we generate D-modes. Now, in addition to the scalar modes, inflation also predicts a nearly scale-invariant spectrum of gravitational waves. So a measurement of this tensor contribution would provide a direct measurement of the expansion rate of the universe during inflation, as well as its energy scale. So we can see here that if the tensor contribution were 1% that of the scalar contribution or more, we would be probing that inflation happened at the God scale. And these are energy scales that are far above any energy scale that can be probed or will ever be probed in accelerators in Earth. We would also be able to test the field excursion during inflation. I'm showing you here the leaf bound that tells us that if the tensor contribution were more than 1% that of the scalar contribution, we would be probing that the inflaton field must have moved over a super Planckian distance in field space. Okay, so this is the physics, among other physics, that we would be learning from such a detection. So here I'm showing you the B-mode power spectrum as a function of multiple moment or angular scale in the sky. In black, I'm showing you the contribution from gravitational lensing. And in blue, I'm showing you the contribution from a gravitational wave, primordial gravitational wave signal. So the scattering of photons of free electrons during reionization generates a bump at very large scales, and the scattering of photons of free electrons at recombination generates a bump at smaller scales. As we have learned over the past 3 years, if you read the New York Times, I'm sure you were aware of the bicep measurement of B-modes in the sky. And so when I started as a postdoc at Harvard, I was very excited about the potential theoretical implications of a primordial gravitational wave detection, so I joined the joint analysis between bicep and Planck. And these are our current results over here. I'm showing you the probability distribution function of the tensor to scalar ratio. Let's take a look at the black curve. The black curve is the most up-to-date constraint. It comes from taking bicep and keck at 150 gigahertz and 95 gigahertz and adding the different Planck channels to be able to test for foregrounds. So what we saw is that there is no significant evidence, as we all know, for gravitational waves. And we put an upper bound for the tensor to scalar ratio that should be less than 0.09 at the 95% confidence level. OK, since I'm out of time and I'm finishing, I will tell you the plan for, that we have as a community for the future. I'm showing you here, in this figure, I'm showing you the approximate raw experimental sensitivity as a function of years. We first had WMAP, then we had Planck. And as a community, we are building a case for an experiment that will have different telescopes around the world known as CMB Stage 4. The CMB Stage 4 science book was already submitted to the archive, and if you want more information, you can go to this website. It was proposed to the different agencies. And so what we expect to learn with the CMB Stage 4 experiment, in the inflationary side, some of the things that we expect to learn is we expect to gain a lot more information on the tensor to scalar ratio. So right now, we stand here. Sigma r is about 0.03. We expect to be reaching, after 3 years of CMB stage 4, a sigma r of about 5 × 10⁻⁴. This is some of the science that we will be able to learn with CMB stage 4. There are many other questions. In fact, I have been leading the dark matter part of this science book. We expect to learn about more about dark matter, dark energy, neutrinos, inflation. So if you're interested, you should look at this number in the archive. OK, so let me finish here. What I, in conclusion, I told you how we can probe the inflationary shape of the potential using CMB and large-scale structure observations. I showed you how the large-scale structure of the universe offers a unique way of probing physical properties of primordial particles, such as their spin. I showed you the latest constraints on primordial gravitational waves. They should be r is less than 0.09 at the 95% level confidence level. And many more experiments are planned, are measured, and will be measuring CMB B-mode soon. Bicep 3 and Keck at 220 gigahertz, EBEX, Polar Bear, Cubix, Quixote, Advanced ACPOL, SPT3G, the Simons Observatory, CMBS4, Lightbird, Pixie, Core, etc., etc. I put in blue the ones that I contributed to. But so the limits on primordial gravitational waves will tighten over the next decade, so stay tuned. Thank you.
Well, can I ask the first question, Cora?
Yes.
Suppose you just restrict your attention to low modes, the angular scales above, say, 2 degrees, where you know there's no messy astrophysics of any kind. Can you do very much just with those? Because all the smaller angular scales than that are affected by gas dynamics before recombination and nonlinearities, etc. So is it cleaner if you just take the low modes?
That's true. So you could look, and there are, in fact, experiments such as CLASS looking at the bump here. You cannot see it. But you can look at the reionization bump and look at those. And yes, those should be cleaner. And there are experiments such as CLASS looking for those, in fact.
So when you look at the temperature power spectrum, there is a clear feature for ELS around 25 that is observed on Planck and was there in a minor way at WMAP.
Yes.
I wonder if this could be interpreted any way than physics.
Yes, that's a question. In fact, part of our motivation came from that. So there were many groups that claim that there is a step in the inflationary potential should make that feature more likely. And so this was part of our motivation to make a general and model-independent analysis. The significance that was observed for such a model was you know, a delta chi square of about 8, but with 3 additional degrees of freedom. So the significance for that kind of those kind of models is marginal. Yes. But you could build up inflationary models to try to make the dip at L of 20 and the bump at L of 40 more likely. Yes.
There's a theory of the start of the universe. At time t equals 0, there was a physical singularity. It had an energy mass of 10 to the exponent, 54 kilograms, which is the energy of our universe, and it had near infinite density. By the Planck time, that singularity had increased in size. It still had an energy of 10 to the 54 kilogram, but the density was much lower. When you talked about the cosmic timeline, you started it at the Planck time. My question is the model I described for what happened between t equals 0 and the Planck time incorrect? And if it is incorrect, is there an alternative model for the start of the universe?
I don't study time t equals 0. So all my work starts later than that singularity.
Yes, right.
And Joe, that's an open question, actually.
Yes. Joe.
I think you mentioned that there's a possibility to probe the nature of dark matter using CMB and large-scale structure. Can you say a little bit more about dark matter?
Yes, sure. There are many things we can learn. For example, we could learn about dark matter annihilation using the CMB. And the reason for that is that, so this is, you know, this is not related to this talk, but I can tell you because this is interesting and this is some of the things that CMB stage 4 will be able to do. So when dark matter annihilates, it produces a shower of particles at very large energies. These particles ionize the universe. There are more free electrons in the universe, so this means that the photons that are coming toward us from the last scattering surface scatter in other directions. So the end result is a suppression of the CMB temperature and power spectrum at small scales because of these photons scattering because of this extra ionization. And an additional large-scale polarization due to the extra scattering of the photons of free electrons. So you can look for these effects with better polarization experiments. And in fact, our forecasts show that you can have significant improvement on the limits, or perhaps detect, if we are optimistic, dark matter annihilation using more sensitive polarization maps.
Thank you. Time for one more question, if there's one.
I think there is.
Is there? Yeah. Yes.
Can you just explain a little bit, just in your first slides, you mentioned the slow roll of the field, and you mentioned before that the pressure was less than minus 3 or density. So the pressure was negative?
Yes.
Yeah.
So can you just explain where do you... Because the energy density is positive of the scalar field?
Yes.
So how do you get the negative pressure out of
it? A scalar field actually has a negative pressure.
Yes.
Yeah. So does that contradict the energy conditions of general relativity? Because general relativity has these energy... So you said P is less than minus 3 rho or something?
That's right.
So doesn't that violate the...
It doesn't contradict anything. No, you can build up models like that because, in fact, the universe is expanding in an accelerated fashion. So in that case, with a scalar field, you can have positive energy density and negative pressure, yes.
Well, Cora, thank you very much for
that.
Thank you. Congratulations again. Our third talk is by Jim Gates, and I'm going to read out his title, which says, the title is, the 1,358,954,496 matrix elements to get from SUSY differential equations to pictures, codes, card games, music, computers, and back again, all in half an hour. So, over to you.
Well, I have half an hour to complete an incredible journey. Let's see if we can get started. Okay, so let's get started because this is a lot of distance to cover. I've spent my entire professional career studying supersymmetry, which, as many of you know, has not been observed in nature. So a lot of people like to say, well, why would you waste a lifetime of energy and activity looking for this strange thing? And it has to do with the fact that the vacuum behavior of supersymmetrical theories is quite unlike any other relativistic field theories we've ever encountered. And a lot of us think that's significant. So it's not a, you know, we, in my generation, we weren't attracted to it because we were trying to complete the standard model. It was this very strange behavior of quantum field theory that seemed to fascinate us. So let's get started, as I said. Okay, so here's a standard model, a representation where we see the quarks and the leptons, the gauge particles. And of course, a few years ago, we added the Higgs boson to this picture with the discovery of the Higgs. The announcement was made on the 4th of July. So I like to say the Higgs boson was born on the 4th of July. Back in the 1950s, we first started to learn that diagrams like this were very important in understanding the spectrum of nuclear matter. These are so-called weight space diagrams. What we see in these two diagrams are the triplets of quarks and the anti-triplet of quarks that come to us and are the basis for SU3. And then, of course, when you have quarks, you can make composite states. This is the octet state, which can be thought of as a combination of a quark-antiquark pair in a bound state. This next one is the decouplet, which in fact was the discovery that changed particle physicists' mind about the usefulness of group theory. I recall for you that at some point there was a lecture given at CERN where the two particles at the penultimate level were discovered, and Murray Gell-Mann was in the audience, and he had been studying what was then called the eightfold ray. And at the end of the presentation, he got up and made, in an audience much like this, made a prediction. And said that you will soon find another particle, and because he understood the energy gaps, he was able to state what the energy gap would be, and within a year, the Omega particle was found. And that's what turned all of us particle physicists into fans of group theory. So, we want to move beyond the standard model. We want to do supersymmetry. So, there has been an enormous amount of work extending the standard model in a way that's consistent with the principles of supersymmetry. We will simply recognize that work in the following two diagrams. This is what our universe looks like without supersymmetry. What we've shown here are the distinctions between bosons and fermions, and namely the objects that either obey or do not obey the Pauli exclusion principle, and whether the particles that we're observing are carriers or gauge carriers for forces, or whether they're the objects that the forces act upon. So this is what nature looks like to us right now when we go to Geneva. On the other hand, this is what supersymmetry in its simplest incarnation tells us. It tells us that we're missing a large part of nature, and that some of this, the lightest one of these extra particles that I've added, is the so-called lightest supersymmetric particle, or LSP, and many people think it is an excellent candidate to describe the dark matter that on the cosmological side, as in the talk that we just heard about, an excellent candidate to provide the dark matter that's needed to close the consistency of lambda CDM, and which is our most accurate view of the universe right now. So that's supersymmetry in a nutshell. Supersymmetry, turns out, is like all of the physics that we do. I like to say we physicists should rename ourselves into a company called Equations Are Us, because that's how we make our living. We solve differential equations and use those predictions to describe reality, and other people, engineers and businesses, have found our ability to do this very useful. It leads to things like the World Wide Web. So Equations Are Us, that's who we are as a group. So these are the equations that describe what the describe supersymmetry, where in the middle of these equations, this object psi is half an electron. More technically, this is a Majorana fermion that this equation describes. The A's and B's are the super partners that you hear about. So if I had two psi's and two A's and two B's, the two psi's could be combined to a complex object, which would be the electron. And then the four, two A's and two B's, would be spin zero super partners to the electron. We call them selectrons. In a similar manner, Maxwell theory gets extended. We start off with the photon, and then we have these differential operators called supercharges that allow us to transition to the second part of the diagram that I had shown you before. And so we would see in nature, at some point, we hope, a set of objects we called photinos. Oops. And then finally, we heard about tensor modes in the previous talk, but in all theories that involve supersymmetry and string theory, and I know everyone's not a big fan of string theory, but if string theory turns out to be accurate, it makes a very interesting prediction, namely that there are particle states associated with gravity that are not spin particles. They are something we call the dilaton and the axion, and this is in fact a description of the differential equations that allow the dilaton, the axion, to enter the array of equations that would modify the standard model. Okay, so that's physics. We're about to leave the world of physics and enter a mathematical world. The way we're going to do this is, well, these objects that I showed you are fields. They depend on both space and time. And so since I like to play with mathematics in strange ways, let me take those fields and do a funny sort of reduction. Namely, let me pick a line in the forward light cone, which you see illustrated in our diagram here. So let me pick an arbitrary line in the forward light cone and only analyze the dynamics of those fields along this single line in four space. Effectively, by doing this, I'm removing degrees of freedom from the field because I've now reduced them to a function of a single variable. But still, this property of supersymmetry survives this kind of parsing. So let me study what comes out of this process. Well, our differential equations reduce. We still have the so-called supercharges, but the only derivatives that are left to act on the fields are time derivatives. So we've now reduced a quantum field theory basically back to quantum mechanics. So here is the multiplet with the electron, here's the photon multiplet, and here is the so-called tensor supermultiplet, which contains the axion-dilaton pair, if you believe something like string theory is correct. Now, you would think that this is a very violent process and that I have lost all sorts of information about how to do field theory in four dimensions. But in fact, surprisingly enough, an enormous amount of information survives this process, and I and some collaborators, mathematicians, other physicists, have been studying what gets left over when you carry this process out. Now, once again, I remind you, what I've done is very great violence to the field theory. I start off with a field theory in four dimensions. I rip part of its degrees of freedoms apart, and then I keep a certain subset of them on which I can show supersymmetry still exists. And then now I'm going to be faced with, having done all this violence, how much information does this reduced theory retain? So we've reduced our theory from a four-dimensional world to a world of one-dimensional supersymmetric quantum mechanics. And when you're in supersymmetric quantum mechanics, well, life gets much simpler. After all, quantum mechanics really is simpler than quantum field theory. So many things that we can study in this simpler context very explicitly. But once you do this, some puzzles arise. The puzzles amount to, if you look at the mathematics of these reduced objects and as a mathematician would, what's the definition of these objects that you're finding? What you find is that there's a combinatorial explosion. So in fact, instead of going from those three different kinds of matter and energy that I showed you before, if you do this reduction process, you do find some objects, these objects we call adinkras. However, for four colors, four open nodes, and four closed nodes, there are 36,864 different ones of these mathematical objects that you can construct. And so then you have to begin to then, you know, are you really able to reconstruct the higher dimensions from this? So I'm going to argue yes. And adinkra, by the way, is a word that a colleague of mine, Michael Fox, and I stole from West Africa in traditional colonial fashion. You know, when you find an interesting piece of mathematics, you want to name it something interesting. So that was our attempt to do something interesting. So the way that it works is start with hypercubes. And I don't care what dimension of hypercubes you start with. For our examples, for four-dimensional physics, we need to start with hypercubes in four dimensions, not three-dimensional hypercubes. So here's a four-dimensional hypercube projected to the two-plane, just like we do with three dimensions. And then what we do is we take this object, we dress the vertices with open and closed nodes. Each node is a function. The open nodes close to, of course, one of bosons. The open nodes are bosons, the closed nodes are fermions. So we put a set of fermions at each vertex. And since it's a cube, you can see that guarantees equal numbers of bosons and fermions. And if you stop and think about supersymmetry, one of the attributes of supersymmetry in our world is that the number of supersymmetrical fermionic degrees is exactly the same as the number of bosonic degrees. So you can begin to see a mathematical reason for some of the structure of supersymmetry if you say they're somehow related to hypercubes. We next color each parallel line the same color. What that means, oh, by the way, these parallel lines that you're looking at are actually the orbits of the differential equations that I was showing you before. If you think about this in group theory language, you can take a group theory, let's say a rotation generator, act on a state, and it gives you a different state. And that transition is the orbit of the generators. And you can look at it on all possible states. That's what you're looking at here in terms of supersymmetry. And so finally, our rule is that no two boson nodes and fermion nodes could be at the same height. So we get this object here. How much information does this contain about four-dimensional physics? That's the puzzle. Well, I'm going to first take you to two dimensions, because the first thing I'm going to tell you is that these pictures allow you to reconstruct the differential equations themselves. They're a little bit like Feynman diagrams. You know, if you've learned how to do relativistic quantum field theory, you can take a Feynman diagram and then turn it back into an integral expression for a scattering amplitude. In the same way, these objects encode supersymmetry transformation laws. And in fact, the picture to the left of this, it has exactly the same amount of information as the differential equations that you see on the right-hand side of this image. Now, you can also begin to imagine that these are almost like real objects. So you can play little games with them, like say, well, gee, it's a piece of macrame. If there are two beads, I can lift one up. And then I get this image after lifting. And in fact, it turns out it's a slightly different set of differential equations. So you can manipulate the differential equations on one side by manipulating the graphical images on the other side of this wall that we're starting to break through. So here's our electron multiplet rendered as a picture through this process. Here's our photon multiplet rendered as a picture. And here is our axion multiplet rendered as a picture. So you look at those three pictures, you say, well, gee, they all look alike to me. So what happened to this retention of information that, because you were claiming in four dimensions that you know how to tell a scalar from a spin one field, and now if they're all alike, how do you tell them? So that's something we began to puzzle. By the way, since I'm doing pictures, here's some more of them. These are much more complicated examples. And this is, in fact, my favorite one of all the ones we've looked at so far. These are pictures of sets of differential equations through this process. Now, it turns out that one of the first surprising things about this is that there are error-correcting codes in these pictures. First of all, how do the bits get there? We'll answer that in a minute. But the error-correcting codes control the irreducibility of these representations. In fact, the way that one can see that the error-correcting codes are there is to say, let's just give a name to one of the nodes and then use the colors of the links to name everybody else. So if I move along a red node, I will change the first zero into one. If I move along a green node, I'll change the second zero to the one. Blue node, third, and black node, fourth. And if I do this consistently, I have a way of naming every single node depending on that describes how they're connected back to the one fiducial reference node that I picked. And now we can see where the bits come from. Because you see, I told you we start with hypercubes. Start with the ordinary cube in three space. You can locate the position of the vertices. One way to do that is by a series of plus and minus ones. So you can say there's a vertex at 1, 1, 1. There's a vertex at 1, 1, minus 1. There's a vertex at 1, minus 1, 1. And you go through the entire sequence, and you've located the vertices of a cube. Now, 1 and minus 1, of course, correspond to minus 1 to either the zero power or the first power. And so cubes naturally bring bits with them. Whenever you have something that has the topology of a cube, it will necessarily have a description in terms of bits. Now, that doesn't make it error-correcting codes, but it does say that there's an information theoretic structure that enters the equation that has nothing to do with trying to solve the differential equations. It's part of the structure of the equations. And when we first made this discovery about seven years ago, I was astounded. I have such collaborators that I will acknowledge at the end of the talk. And we didn't talk about this at all. I was really struck because when I was young, I remember hearing Wheeler, the discussion of Wheeler's It From Bit, which said that essentially the entire architecture of physical reality rests on information theory. And then when I was a young person, I thought that was a crazy statement. How in the world could that possibly be true? And then 35 or 40 years later, I'm finding in my own work a way by which this statement may be true. So I concluded that if you remain a theoretical physicist long enough, you too can become crazy. So here's that object that I showed you, which is a rendition of a four-dimensional set of differential equations. Let's play with it for a bit. Because remember, I can manipulate this object, and as I'm manipulating it, it's doing something on the differential equation. In fact, when I change the vertical heights of nodes in this, I'm doing derivatives. Integrals when I go down. Derivatives take me up. So here we actually just finished three integrals. You can see there are two identical subcells here. And since they're identical, you might say, well, gee, suppose the functions on one side of this were the same as the functions on the other. Does that restrict, or does that a supersymmetry allow that? And the answer turns out to be yes, but only if you preserve the links between the sides. And that's what the rest of this movie is doing through a sequence of operations. This movie is actually mathematically accurate. There's a set of transformations on the differential equations that I could show you that do this. And that's how we actually constructed this movie. And then I, of course, went to a very talented graphical artist and said, I've got these equations that are doing this. Give me a picture that shows this. And this is the image that shows that comes out. This object that I have on the other side retains that bit structure information. In fact, the way the nodes were combined is that if you started with the initial nodes, they had all kinds of addresses between four zeros and four ones. The way the diagram gets combined is that you only combine nodes when you take the information structures and the sums of the addresses add up to 1, 1, 1, 1. 1111 is the simplest block linear self-dual error correcting codes. So error correcting codes, if you think of this as a game of origami, controls the folding of this mathematical device and therefore controls the form of the differential equations that possess the property of supersymmetry. There are a set of matrices associated with each of these diagrams. If you've done some graph theory, you perhaps know the expression adjacency matrices. So these diagrams have adjacency matrices attached to them. And because of the way we constructed them, by starting from hypercubes, dressing the vertices with open and closed nodes, having parallel lines with the same color, then one other rule I didn't mention, which was odd dashing, because of all those rules, when you look at the matrices that normally are adjacency matrices, you find out they obey an algebra. And that's what I've written for you. Now this algebra, since I started with supersymmetrical theories that had gamma matrices, you might think these things are gamma matrices that I wind up with, but they're not. Gamma matrices in space-time have to be related to the Minkowski metric. These objects are related purely to the Euclidean inner product. So they're not gamma matrices, but they're something that are Clifford algebras, it turns out, but Euclideanized Clifford algebras. So where does card games enter? Well, when you start looking at this 36,864 objects that you can build from these rules, at some point, it's like going on a safari and deciding that you have to be able to classify the life forms that you're encountering. You have to find some rules. You know, some things are cat-like, a lion, a tiger. Well, that's cat-like. On the other hand, there are other things that are not cat-like. Well, for example, a hyena is not cat-like, or some various birds are not cat-like. So in the same sort of way, you have to classify this zoo of mathematical objects. And one of the tricks that we found for doing this is that if you look very carefully at those diagrams that I showed you and start looking at closed paths, basically taking line integrals, you find out that the line integrals along those paths are distinctly different. And that begins to tell you how to recognize these as different animals, to tell a cat from a bird in a colloquial language. And when we did this, we realized that there are, in fact, six different corrals of animals among our 36,864 objects. And then the next question, that one of my mathematical colleagues said, well, you guys have these chorales, what's causing that to come into existence? His name is Kevin, and so I like to call this Kevin's pizza, because he's the one who prompted us to think what mathematical structures at work here. You can pull this object apart. It has different properties under duality. That's actually very important, because if you're a field theorist, you know, for example, that spin one field under electromagnetic duality goes into another spin one field. But a scalar field under electromagnetic duality goes into a skew symmetric tensor. And so these objects begin to demonstrate properties like the properties that you see in four dimensions, even though they're in principle not four dimensional. And where do the card games come from? Well, it turns out that if you look at all of the objects that I'm talking about, you can classify them according to the permutation group on four objects. And in fact, it's like having a game of four-card Monty. The permutations on the cards actually classify the animals that you see here. Where does music come in? Well, that structure I just showed you is, mathematically, is sometimes called the Feiergruppe, named by Felix Klein. Basically, we physicists would say it's a Z2Z grading of some mathematical structure. But it turns out the Feiergruppe is also governs the transitions in a form of music. The music was invented by Arno Schoenfeld in the early 1900s. Here's the Klein group written as a Cayley table, with the way we normally write group theory, multiplication of elements. But the Klein group governs the transitions in the duodecaphony of Arno Schoenberg. Now, I don't know if any of you are fans of Schoenberg. I'm not. But I was shocked when I found this out. I began to go back and listen to his music. And now we're going to try to get back to doing some physics. So if someone gave you a set of 36,864 objects and you're trying to classify which are cats, birds, or dogs, you would try to find some characteristics by which to do that. So at the beginning of this month, I put a paper on the archive. In this paper, what we have described is a set of codes for classifying these mathematical cats, dogs, and birds. Since there are 36,864 of these objects, and since our method of classification, which I'll get to shortly, involves a matrix, then the size of that matrix is 36,864 by 36,864, and that's the number that Sir Martin read in the introduction of my talk, and that's why that number is relevant for us. It turns out that these objects that I've told you about have deep mathematical connections to Riemann surfaces. Now, again, I don't know if there are any fans of string theory out there, but Riemann surfaces are intimately part of string theory because that's how you do quantum string theory, is by looking at strings on two-dimensional, higher genus surface. Genus counts actually quantum loops for string theory. And yet, in the way that we're doing these things, I have a set of mathematical colleagues, Charles Duran, Kevin Ego, I've already named, Jordan Kostiuk, and Greg Landweber. And by studying these objects, what they have found is that you can use these funny little graphs to reconstruct Riemann surfaces. Riemann surfaces, the same objects that show up in string theory. We are not doing string theory, but we are finding tantalizing hints that elements of the math from string theory are intimately connected not just to string theory, but to supersymmetry itself. And in fact, we have a little formula down here which Chuck and his collaborators derived, which says that the genus of the surface that you put one of these objects on is equal to 1 times the number of open nodes in the object times the number of colors minus 4. And there's a very beautiful derivation for why this works. It starts off with what's called ramification of CP2 over the sphere. When you have it ramified at 3 points, 1 point you can send to infinity, you have 2 points left over, you can think of those 2 points as being the origin of bosons and fermions. So we're starting to see mathematics demand the structure that we see in supersymmetry. And then there's several other constructions. One of them is called the Bailey map, where you take this object that initially starts off with one open, one closed, because it's the ramified points with a line connecting them. And then you can pull the line apart using a mirror morphic transformation in the two plane, so that it then becomes a beach ball. And then you finally pull the ends apart, the nodes apart, and you reconstruct the adinkras. By doing this process, that's how one is led to this connection between field theory on the one hand and algebraic geometry on the other. So here's an adinkra laid out on a torus. The A and B cycles, we've taken the donut, we've cut it in half and opened it up, and then we've laid the adinkra on top of it. This tells us how to construct this. And so one of the interesting things of this observation is it says that if supersymmetry exists in our world, it's equivalent to having mathematical objects that live on tori. We've never seen these kinds of statements come purely out of field theory before. So how do we actually classify the animals? Let me go forward. We classify them by taking these matrices, which satisfy this, we call garden algebra. Instead of taking plus, we take minus signs. Those are the things that are like spin generators. And then once you have the spin generators, you can calculate traces of them. They're basically plaquettes. And so you look to see the values of the plaquettes for all these 36,864 objects. And it turns out the values are very, very few. But we've been able to formulate a mathematical conjecture. One of my collaborators wrote a code that calculated all 1 billion all 1.3 billion matrix elements. And you come up with this incredibly sparse matrix from doing this. Most of its entries are zero. The entries that are non-zero only take on four values, plus one-third, minus a-third, one. Those are the only non-vanishing values. Why those values? This will bring us back again. I told you that I started this talk as a four-dimensional field theorist. So let me, as a four-dimensional field theorist, do a calculation for you right before your eyes. Here, what we're looking at is the fermion that is half an electron. Here's the fermion that's the superpartner to the photon. Here's the fermion that's the superpartner to the axion-dilaton pair. Let me do a certain calculation on them. If you do that, you'll generate a set of objects, these H objects, and they're simply numerical matrices. If you then take those numerical matrices, you find out they all have a universal form written in terms of four-dimensional gamma matrices and some integers. And in fact, for each of those four-dimensional field theories, the only thing that changes are these integers. And if you calculate them on the three multiplets that I showed you, and there are a few more I could show you, you can show that if you take this object as an inner product on the integers that show up in this formula, the values of this matrix are simply 1, 0, and minus 1/3. In other words, directly in four-dimensional field theory, there is a property of these objects that generates the numbers that you see in this incredibly sparse matrix down in one-dimensional quantum mechanics world. And so, in fact, we think there is a kind of holography at work here.
What happened with plus one?
I'll come back to that during Q&A. So I showed you at near the beginning weight space diagrams for the quarks. You're all familiar with those. We now are in position to do weight space diagrams for supersymmetrical representations. And it turns out that for the ones I showed you, the weight space diagrams are basically a tetrahedron inscribed within a cube. There's the vector multiply. It occupies that vertex. One of the other multiplets we call the axial vector multiplet. Namely, the gauge field has the opposite parity from the photon. The tensor multiplet was the axion tensor multiplet from supergravity. And then it's parity double. And then there are five more objects which I can show that this is a three-dimensional space, but these other five objects live in the orthogonal directions. And these are all the representations that have minimal supersymmetry. all of them map into our tetrahedron, both in four-dimensional world and in one-dimensional world. So I have just made it back again. Thank you.
Yeah. Quick question. A beautiful and complex lecture, but I have a simple question. Why do the super partners have such different masses?
We don't know the answer to that question. It's a, how do I say this? We don't really know why the Higgs particle has the mass it has. We don't really know the answer to why the W boson has the mass it has. And so this question about the mass of super partners is in the same category of questions. Namely, what's generating the mass spectrum in the elementary particle world? And although at one point back in the 50s we thought we were closing in on that, nowadays I don't know anyone who has a good theory along those lines. Yes, ma'am. No, I'm sorry, Dr. Trimble was next.
Sorry?
Go ahead. In one sentence, you use both folding. In one sentence, you use both folding and error correction.
Yes.
That sounds like proteins and genes.
Yes, it does. Thank you, Virginia. Every since I have been doing this work, which has been about a decade, I have had the strange sense that I'm doing a form of biology because it really does sound like protein folding. And so I think of these diagrams I showed you, I think of them as the genes for the equations that I normally study as a four-dimensional field theorist. And in fact, the methodologies that we are using to study these objects, for example, classifying them, someone working in genomics would probably say, gee, that looks a whole lot like what we do. So yes, there appears to be some kind of weird merger in this viewpoint between genetics, computer science, and the mathematics that we physicists are normally used to using in the differential equations that we describe nature with.
Yes. Barbara, yeah.
So the LHC, when it started up, of course, there were many wonderful things that one can do with the LHC, and you know what my question is.
Go ahead and ask it.
What do you make of the fact that we haven't seen any evidence of the supersymmetric
First of all, as I said, I'm sort of a Generation 2 researcher in the area of supersymmetry, and so we've been working at this a lot of... And it was amazing to us in the middle to early 80s when the particle physics community as a whole decided that the idea of supersymmetry was such a great attraction that a large fraction of the community invested in doing research in the area. Before the LHC turned on, in 2006, I was asked to write an article as part of the celebration of the 75th anniversary of the American Physical Society. And so I wrote an article whose title was, Is String Theory Phenomenologically Viable? And in this article, I explicitly said that as a longtime researcher in the area of supersymmetry, I did not expect supersymmetry to be discovered when the LHC was turned on. Well, that was 2006. There were very few, or essentially almost none of us, who would make that kind of statement then. But since I had watched the evolution of the field, I knew the history of how the field made the transition to saying, oh, we're going to find supersymmetry tomorrow. And if you have someone of my age, you were dubious all along. So I explicitly said that. Now, LHC is in run two now. So about 2 years ago, since I wrote this other naysaying article for Physics Today, about 2 years ago, the British physics journal, Physics World, asked me my opinion about the prospects of discovery of supersymmetry in the second scientific run at the LHC. And in deference to the way that you pose your question, there's been a lot of effort to search it, but I opened the article with the following analogy. If you were an explorer and came to the United States, and explored all up and down the East Coast looking for giant sequoia trees, you were likely to be disappointed. And that, in my opinion, is where we are in terms of examining supersymmetry in nature via the LHC. So I wouldn't bet the farm on the second scientific discipline run also. Although, since I'm now 66, I do have more hopes.
This will be the last question back there.
Yeah. Adinkra on a torus sounds like SU2 cross SU2. What about SU3 and U1?
So the way, at the beginning of my presentation, I talked about the way that we go from four-dimensional field theory down to this like one-dimensional quantum mechanics. We think of these things as, like I said, either the genes or the shadows of the higher-dimensional theory. And when you carry that process out in the forward light cone, it turns out that the SO4, there's an SO4 symmetry that emerges, and that is why SU2 shows up, because SO4, as you probably know, is actually two SU2s put together, at least locally. We don't see with four-color adinkras, which are the ones relevant for simple supersymmetry in our world, we simply do not see room for the emergence of something like SU3. If you work with more colors, which is also equivalent to saying, I'm going to look at the physics in a universe with more than four directions, we haven't examined it, but I don't see any reason why you shouldn't expect something like SU3 to emerge. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you very much. That's the end of our session. So please thank Jim and all the three speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Martin. It's so good to see you.
It was great talking.